Hello everyone, welcome to the introduction class. So in this introduction class, we are going to discuss about the syllabus of third semester. So this third semester especially, we are going to discuss about the syllabus of paper 2 and paper 3. The paper 2 is organic spectroscopy 1 and the paper 3 is organic synthesis 1. Let us start with the paper 3, which is organic synthesis 1. What is organic synthesis? It's a branch of chemistry which is mainly deals with the intentional construction of organic compounds. That means you are going to synthesize organic compounds using different kind of methodologies or reagents or strategies. In this paper, you are going to study the formation of CC single bonds. You are going to study the formation of CC double bonds. And we are going to study the reactions of unactivated CH bonds and organoborane reagents and protecting groups also. Apart from these conventional studies, we are going to study the newer method, that is phase transfer catalysis with the crown ethers. So let us see the syllabus in this paper 3. So it has 4 units. The first unit deals with the formation of CC single bonds. How to achieve this CC single bonds? So that is alkylation. Alkylation is a process via enolates can generate CC single bond. Or you can use star-kinamine reactions, you can use organosulfur compounds, you can also use organometallic reagents to form a CC single bond in organic synthesis process. The unit 2 deals with the formation of carbon-carbon double bonds. So this unit mainly deals with the formation of double bonds. So how to achieve this CC double bonds in organic synthesis process? Mainly elimination reactions, organophosphorus compounds, or using organosilicon compounds, you can achieve this carbon-carbon double bond formation. And in this unit, you are going to study about metathesis which is used by Grubbs first and second generation catalysts. And unit 3 deals with the reaction of unactivated CH bonds. So the bond between carbon and hydrogen is very strong and it is difficult to break. So to make the bond more active towards the reactions, so you have to activate the bond and conduct the reactions by replacing that H with another functional groups. That is actually you are going to study in this topic. And then organoborans. Organoborans, the boron which is directly connected to carbon called organoborans. These reagents are different types. There are BS3THF, dicyclohexyl borane, decimyl borane, thexyl borane, 9-borobicyclononane, monoisopinocampinyl borane, which is simply called as IPCBH2, and diisopinocampinyl borane, simply called as IPC2BH. These reagents are very useful in organic transformations such as oxidation, protonolysis, and isomerization, etc. There are a lot of applications you have with this organoborans. And unit 4 deals with the protecting groups. So protecting groups. A group, what is protecting group? A group whose use makes possible to react a less reactive functional group selectively over the more selective functional group. For example, I have a starting material called ethyl acetate, which is having two functionalities here. One is carbonyl and one more is ester. So if you treat this substrate with the Grignard reagent, okay, phenyl magnesium bromide, especially this phenyl magnesium bromide is susceptible to react with the carbonyl, more electrophilic carbon. Okay, this reacts with the more electrophilic carbon. And gives you your required alcohol. So if you want to make this ester to react with this phenyl magnesium bromide, so this process is not possible. So what we have to do is use a reagent, that means use a group which makes this less reactive functionality more selective towards reagent, comparatively more reactive functional group. That is, here more reactive functional group is carbonyl, so that first you treat this substrate with the ethylene glycol, which protect this functional group to react with the Grignard reagent. So now with this protected carbonyl group, now if you treat with the phenyl magnesium bromide, that is Grignard reagent, with the 2 moles, generally it produces your required alcohol. So finally you can deprotect this carbonyl so that you can get your alcohol. See, in this reaction what happens, the carbonyl which is more reactive is not reacted by this Grignard reagent, because you protected this more reactive group with a protecting group followed by you treated with this Grignard reagent, so that you are getting an expected product. What you are expecting, that product you are getting by this protected production process. So in this syllabus you are going to study different kind of protecting groups for production of alcohols and production of different kind of functional groups, like production of 1,2-diols and production of amines, production of carbonyl, production of carboxylic acids. Apart from these syllabus, this is all conventional organic synthesis. Apart from this, there is a newer method that is called phase transfer catalysis. So what is phase transfer catalysis? So the here a catalyst which mainly useful for the transfer of or migrating your required substrate from one phase to another phase. If you consider any heterogeneous catalysis, okay, there you have to transfer your reagent from one phase to another phase. So that is actually phase transfer catalyst. So in this unit we are going to study synthetic applications of phase transfer catalysis, and discussion about Crown ethers also done. This is all about synthesis, organic synthesis 1, that is paper 3. And next let us discuss about paper 2, that is organic spectroscopy 1. So this paper, which is collaborative paper with the paper 3, so that means what all you are synthesizing in the paper 3 using different kind of strategies. That means you are taking some substrates and you are synthesizing some products using different kind of reagents. Okay, I told you organoborans, organosulfur, organosilicon, phosphorus are different kind of methodologies or strategies to synthesize these products. Okay, so you have to confirm, you have to characterize whether this product formed in your reaction or not. So as an organic chemist, you need to characterize this organic compound. So you have one choice to characterize this compounds, that is organic spectroscopy. What is organic spectroscopy? So what is spectroscopy especially? Spectroscopy means the interaction of electromagnetic radiation with the matter. Okay, you have a sample or matter with you. So the interaction of this electromagnetic radiation with the matter, which brings changes in this matter. So that is actually called spectroscopy. So what is electromagnetic radiation? It's a kind of radiation which varies with the electric and magnetic frequencies simultaneously. So that is actually electromagnetic radiation. When EMR, electromagnetic radiation, occurs, the electron radiations are released as photons, photon bundles of light energy, or quantized harmonic waves which travel at the speed of light. Then based on wavelength, so we have different, based on the wavelength, we have an electromagnetic spectrum. So for example, this spectrum contains different kind of radiations like gamma rays, X-rays, UV rays, visible, IR rays, and microwave rays, finally radio waves. So this is all about electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, this electromagnetic radiation, so this is actually increasing the lambda. So you are increasing the lambda here. That means the wavelength of this radiation is increasing from gamma rays to radio waves, whereas energy is
increasing from radio waves to gamma rays. So here, as we know that E equal to h nu, whereas h is c by lambda, where E is inversely proportional to lambda, or this energy or frequency. So E equal to h nu. So nu equal to nu is indirectly proportional to lambda. So that means frequency always inversely proportional to lambda. So radio frequency, if we have more wavelength, then it has less energy. Let us discuss about the energies. See, this is all about electromagnetic spectrum. You see, from radio, microwave, infrared, visible, ultraviolet, x-ray and gamma rays. See, this is all about the source, electromagnetic spectrum. So what I told you, the spectroscopy means the interaction of electromagnetic radiation with the matter, which brings changes in the matter. So the source present in the electromagnetic radiation, if it interacts with the matter, what happens? That is what about spectroscopy. You can see here there are different rays. We have gamma rays, x-rays, UV, visible, IR, microwave and radio. So I told you wavelength is increasing from here to gamma rays to x-rays, like this. See, it is increasing. So whereas energy decreasing. Okay, what is the use of this radio waves? So when you interact this, that means when you pass this radio wave source to a matter under the magnetic effect, so what happens, there is a excitation of nucleus takes place. So because of this excitation of nucleus, you will understand the environment, the nucleus environment present in the molecule. Okay, this radio wave gives the information about the structure, dynamics, reaction state and the chemical environment of the molecule. So from this NMR, this is also useful in NMR spectroscopy, nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. That means when you pass this radio wave to this matter or sample, what happens, the nucleus under the magnetic field, that will excite from ground state to excited state. Okay, that is actually NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. That is also present in your syllabus. Okay, and then microwave radiation. So this microwave radiation, which is having higher energy than this radio waves, that means lesser wavelength than the radio waves, right? So this is also useful in the electron spin resonance spectroscopy. It is also like a nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. That means when you pass this microwave to this sample, what happens here, the electrons, unshared pair of electrons excite from one position to, that means ground state to excited state. So this electron spin or electron paramagnetic resonance spectroscopy mainly useful for the studying metal complexes of organic radicals. That means the molecules, the complexes should have a unpaired electron, lone electron. Then this ESR spectroscopy is very useful. Come to the IR. So when you pass this IR rays to a matter or to the matter, what happens? It brings some changes in the molecule. What kind of changes it brings? So a bond between two atoms you have in your molecules, right? So when you pass this IR radiation, then the vibration of this bond takes place. Okay, so that means if you have three different type of bonds, for example C single bond C, C double bond C and C triple bond C. So the IR radiation or IR source to vibrate these bonds require more from the CC single bond to CC triple bond. So that means CC single bond requires less IR energy to vibrate compared to C double bond C, and C triple bond C require more energy to vibrate these bonds compared to C double bond C. That means what can we understand? So our molecules has different kind of bonds. For example, you have ketones, alcohols. So you have different kind of bonds in your molecules. So all bonds have different kind of strength. So different kind of IR energy required for the vibration of these bonds. So you can determine the functional groups in organic molecules with the IR spectroscopy. That is very important. And the one more is UV visible spectroscope. So when you pass this UV visible radiation to the molecules, what happens? The excitation of electrons takes place from ground state to excited state. So this UV visible spectroscopy is very useful, and it is very useful in analytical chemistry for the quantitative determination of different halides, and especially for organic chemistry, it is useful for the study of conjugated organic compounds, and then X-rays. So X-rays are having high energy radiation and low wavelength. So these X-rays are useful in the X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. So this in this electron, yes, X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, what happens, this X-rays are emit one electron which is near to the nucleus. Okay, suppose this is nucleus and if 1s orbital you have an electron, so to eject this electron you need more energy. So you need more energy because the attraction between this nucleus and electron is more, so to eject this electron you need this kind of X-ray source. So this X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy is mainly useful to determine the binding energies of electrons in the substance, their binding energies in the substance. And finally, gamma rays. Gamma rays are the highest energy containing rays, and these are all very useful in the bio inorganic chemistry for the study of iron containing proteins and enzymes, especially like cytochromes, non-heme, so heme containing proteins especially. And then these gamma rays are very useful in the inorganic chemistry to study mass bar spectroscopy. So this mass bar spectroscopy is useful for the study of nucleus, especially iron. So iron nucleus, we are going to study iron nucleus. So that's the reason this is very useful. These gamma rays are useful in bio inorganic chemistry for the study of iron containing proteins and enzymes. Among these, in your syllabus you have UV visible spectroscopy, UV visible spectroscopy, IR spectroscopy, NMR spectroscopy, and mass spectrometry. So UV spectroscopy, you know that UV is useful for the excitation of electrons from ground state to that to excitation of bonding and non-bonding electrons from ground state to excited state. So that this gives information about the conjugated bonds in our molecules. And IR spectroscopy, the IR radiation when you pass through the molecule, generally it vibrates the bonds between the atoms, so that it gives the information about the functional groups. So different kind of functional groups has different kind of bonds, so you need different kind of IR source for the vibration of the functional groups. And NMR spectroscopy, the radio wave source is very useful here. Pass this radio wave source to a nucleus which is present in the magnet. Okay, this excite from ground state to excited state. That means it is useful for the study of nucleus, especially like proton and C13, carbon and proton, that is hydrogen nucleus. So what kind of, that means how many number of protons you have, where they have, that means what is the environment of a proton in your molecule, you can study. And what kind of carbon and where is the position of carbon, this kind of information you will get from this NMR spectroscopy. And finally, mass spectrometry. So these spectroscopies are absorption spectroscopies. So that's why you are calling them as spectroscopy. So mass spectrometry, you can't call this as spectroscopy, it's a metric. Because in these three cases, once you use this sample for this spectroscopic technique, you will recover back. Whereas in this mass spectrometry, you can't recover the sample. Because once you keep the sample in the instrument, what happens? Under 70 electron volt, it bombardment of this energy to that molecule, completely it fragments the molecule into different kind of fragments. So based on the fragments, you will know the mass of the particular compound. Okay, this is mass spectrometry is useful for the knowing the mass of the mass molecular weight of the molecule. So UV visible spectroscopy is useful for the determination of conjugated system, and IR spectroscopy is useful for the determination of functional groups in your molecules, and NMR spectroscopy is useful for the knowing the protons and the carbon information, and mass spectrometry is useful for the understanding the determination the molecular weight of the your required substance. So this is all about organic spectroscopy. So from this information you concluded that organic synthesis 1 and organic spectroscopy, these two are collaborative papers. Okay, so these in detail topics of this particular spectroscopy will soon discuss. Thank you.